Now, we're going to be talking about valve springs today, and we're going to find out what they are, why they're important. Probably not the most exciting topic in the world, but as we're going to see, it's actually pretty critical. And if you do get it wrong, if you've got the wrong valve springs to suit the cams or cam that's installed in your engine, you can end up with, first of all, not making the sort of power and torque that that cam should be capable of, but more importantly, it can also risk ending up with some catastrophic engine damage, and nobody wants that. Now, before we get into the webinar though, just a couple of things that have been going on over the last week. And I want to start actually with an Instagram that I put up just the other day, and we'll just head across to my laptop screen now and check that out. If you aren't following us on Instagram, please make sure you do so. We do post, or at least try to post, some pretty interesting content. So this particular car here is one that Jono and I followed at TX2K. We've actually got a tech feature on the Real Street Supra coming up, but the important part here is the fact that, as we can see, the front wheels are definitely not where they're supposed to be. So this is a pretty big problem with drag racing in general. What we'll see is that in a lot of classes, the cars are fitted with wheelie bars. Makes sense, stops us getting into this sort of situation that we can see right here. I should also mention that a second or so after this photo was taken, the driver understandably decided that it was a pretty good idea to back out of the throttle. And of course, when that happens, it's a really delicate balancing act. Generally, the driver's not able to get out of the throttle gently enough to just bring the front wheels down on the ground. And in severe instances, you can end up with the front end of the car coming down so heavily that it damages the chassis, damages the engine and the suspension. And again, nobody really wants that to happen. So while you might be thinking, well, if you're having problems with the car wheelieing like this out of the start line, then fit wheelie bars. In some classes, wheelie bars are illegal. So something that was being tested and prototyped over at TX2K on a few cars was an anti-wheelie software update for the Motec M1 system. And this was actually being developed by John Reed Racing, or John from John Reed Racing. And if those of you out there who aren't familiar with the M1 platform, the Motec M1 ECU can be thought of basically as a blank box of electronics. And this allows the person doing the programming to basically write their own code in order to make that box of electronics do whatever you want. So in this way, the M1 kind of is unlimited. It's just up to the potential and however smart the person writing code is. So in this case, John wanted to write his own anti-wheelie parameters to prevent this sort of situation happening. And in order to do this, we obviously need some way of knowing when the front of the car is in the air. Now, there's a variety of ways of doing this, particularly on sport bikes. Laser ride height sensors can be used. They're quite common. Someone on this particular Instagram asked, well, why can't we just use shock travel potentiometers on the front wheels? Now, of course, the problem with using shock travel potentiometers is that they're going to give you the same reading as soon as the front wheels are 1 millimeter in the air, and that same reading is going to remain right to the point where the car is flipped over on its back and it's upside down on the racetrack. So not particularly useful there unless you want to limit the front wheels coming off the ground at all. So what John ended up developing in conjunction with Sander from Obsidian Motor Group was the use of an IMU, or inertial measurement unit. So this is a unit, actually I've got a photo of this here from Sander's Instagram as well. So this is in prototype form, so it's actually just 3D printed at the moment. But basically, this sits inside the car, generally somewhere around about the center line of the car on the transmission tunnel. And what it does is it outputs a huge amount of data. So normally there'll be a 3-axis G sensor as well as a gyroscope inside of this inertial measurement unit. And what it does, in our interest here for our anti-wheelie function, what it does is it tells the Motec M1 ECU what the current sort of state of the chassis is. And we're looking here at the rate of change of pitch. So whether the front end of the car is coming up into the air, what the current pitch angle is, and also just as importantly, how quickly that pitch angle is changing. So once you've got that data in and it's being processed and it's giving accurate information, then it's relatively easy to write a strategy inside the ECU that in this case looks for a specific pitch angle. Let's say, for example, we don't want the front of the car to pitch up by more than 4 degrees. Well, what we can do there is use a strategy of either ignition retard to just gently reduce engine torque and try and stabilize around that 4 degrees. But of course, if this isn't enough, then it can also incorporate fuel or ignition cutting to more dramatically reduce the engine torque. And then using a PID control algorithm, the front end of the car, that pitch angle can be maintained. This is only normally a problem out to the 60 foot or just a little bit beyond, but this can really make the difference between getting a good pass down the strip and potentially doing some expensive damage to your car. So this is a product that I think at the moment isn't available for public consumption, but I'm assuming as soon as John Reed Racing has done a little bit more development on it, he's happy with how that's working, it will be something that will be available on his specific drag racing M1 packages. Alright, just to update you on what has been going on with some of our own vehicles, and if we head across to my laptop screen again, we have got a 2018 Chevy Silverado with the 6.6 litre Duramax V8 diesel turbo engine that we are doing some development on for our practical diesel tuning course. And one of the problems with this particular platform is that it was supposedly untunable or unbreakable in the aftermarket. Now, the guys from HP Tuners in the US kind of took up that challenge pretty quickly on, and they offer an unlock service. So this is the box of bits that we got back from HP Tuners in the US just last week, and this includes our L5P engine or engine control module, ECM, or powertrain control module as it's also referred to. At the same time, a little box over here on the side is our transmission control module, or TCM. I'm not so interested right now in making tuning changes to the transmission, but it does give us that potential down the track. So we're focusing for the moment on our diesel tuning course, which is obviously just the powertrain control module. So this is the truck. Not really fitting particularly well on our mainline four-wheel drive dyno, but we did get it on there. And in stock form, I think we ended up with a power output of around about 360 wheel horsepower. Now, I wouldn't say I'm done by any stretch of the imagination. Now, 355 horsepower at the rear wheels. Just to give you some indication as well, these trucks are rated at around about 450 flywheel horsepower, I think, from the manufacturer, around about 900 pound-foot of torque. So we've got a pretty decent amount of drivetrain loss there, which would be to be expected. So the green line here on our dyno shows where we're at the moment. Definitely not finished by any stretch of the imagination, but it is still a healthy gain considering this is purely software tuning. So we haven't made any hardware changes at all. So we've gone from 354 horse at the wheels, or whatever that was originally, up to 407 horsepower at the wheels. So we are hoping to get a little bit more out of that as time goes on, and we're going to be developing that course over the coming months. So if you are interested in learning more about diesel tuning, that's going to be perfect for you. In the meantime, if you do want to get started though, we do already have our diesel tuning fundamentals course available. This will teach you all of the fundamental principles behind late model common rail diesel engines. You'll learn all about how the diesel combustion process works. So you can check that out on the courses page of our website at hpacademy.com/courses. Off the top of my head, I think you're going to find that down at the bottom of that page. In terms of our other shop cars as well, we have got a small amount of progress going on with our FD RX-7. So Alan finally got a chance to take off the factory twin turbo. So over here we have got our turblown engineering cast exhaust manifold. So that's just basically in there for a dummy test fit. It's pretty big in the engine bay once we've got the BorgWarner EFR 8474 turbo mounted on the top. The turbo is damn near as big as the engine, but it is all engineered to fit with precision, so there's plenty of room. Well, I wouldn't say plenty of room, there is enough room around everything. So we're pretty excited to get a little bit more progress into that project, and we are at the moment just waiting for a few more fuel system components to turn up from the US, in particular some billet rails, just to make it really easy for us to fit our injector dynamics injectors to it. And the combination we're going through there is a set of 1300 or ID 1300 primaries, and then we are using a set of ID 1700 secondaries. Now, this will be more than enough fuel for pump gas, but it does give us the ability to also run flex fuel. So we're basically future-proof this. At the moment, the engine is completely stock, albeit from what we can gather, it is in good condition. So we're probably not going to be able to push too far with that 8474 turbocharger on a stock 13B at the moment, but it will, as I say, future-proof us for when we put a built motor in there that's a bit stronger. Also updating another one of our shop cars, and this hasn't really seen the light of day for a while. This is our original Toyota 86 development car, our white turbocharged 86. And we sort of got to a point where the car was really a little bit too fast for the lack of safety equipment it had. Around our local racetrack, Highlands Motorsport Park, we are seeing terminal speeds in the order of about 208, 210 kilometres an hour, and it's easily able to pull in excess of 1G through some of the corners. And you sort of start considering what could go wrong if the car kind of fell off at that sort of speed, even if it suffered a mechanical issue that was outside of the control of the driver, and understandably things are going to hurt. So we decided it was time to take a sensible step here and add some safety equipment. So here you can see the multi-point cage that has gone into this. We are also fitting it with a pair of Racetech 119 head restraint seats, and these head restraint seats also are rear mounted, so that's an important aspect. I haven't got a photo of the seats, unfortunately, but what they do is they actually mount to the harness crossbar at the back as well, rather than solely mounting at 4 points on the base of the seat. And this just allows them to be a lot more rigid, and particularly as a driver, not that any of us here are pros. What we really want to do is minimize any amount of flex in that seat. We want to make sure that the seat is rigidly mounted to the chassis, and this allows more control from the driver. You can feel more easily what the car's doing, and also provides a potential increase in safety in the event of an accident. So we are hopefully going to be racing both the Toyota 86s in about 2 weeks' time. As usual with motorsport, we have left it to the absolute last moment. At the moment, there is no engine or gearbox in that white Toyota 86. Likewise, there is no drive shaft for our new 6-speed TTI sequential gearbox in our black V8 powered 86. So, fair to say we've got our work cut out for us, and to make things worse, we're just coming into Easter weekend, so we've got 2 short weeks, but that's all right. We are up for a challenge and we'll do our best. We'll see how far we've managed to get next week. Now, if you are interested in checking out our latest video, let me just get everything lined up here. We have just released, if you head across to my laptop screen, we've just released another interview that John and I filmed when we were over at TX2K in Houston. So this is an interview with Nero. It's basically a tech tour of what is probably one of the most iconic cars in import drag racing history. This is the Titan Motorsports Copper Supra. It's been around since I probably first started getting into cars, developing my own workshop, and it's kind of been an inspiration, I think, for the entire Supra and 2JZ community, as well as import drag racing in general. It's held and set a number of records over the time it has been raced. It's been rebuilt, as most good drag cars are, and it's been updated to modern specifications. So we get a chance to talk to Nero about what goes into this car. In particular, this car is now built specifically for the X275 radial class. So it's a 275mm wide radial drag tire, and it is running primarily in 8th mile events. However, it is a bit versatile in that it can be changed up to run in 1/4 mile and 8th mile events. Particularly on this car, what was a standout in the 2JZ field at TX2K was the fact that this was the only car that was competing with an air-shifted Liberty gearbox. Most of the competitors these days seem to have gone to either a Powerglide 2-speed or a TH400 3-speed automatic transmission. And there are some pros and cons with that. One of the advantages is that the automatic transmission is generally a little bit easier to get the car down the track consistently. In this case, with the Liberty air shifted 5-speed box, it also works in conjunction with a proper drag racing slipper style clutch, where the crew chief actually adjusts the clutch base pressure and the centrifugal weight to adjust how the clutch will hook up. Now, when they get that right, everything works perfectly and the car is incredibly fast. However, it is a real tightrope that they are walking to get one of those slipper style clutches dialed in absolutely correct, and it will vary as the track conditions change as well. So the advantage, of course, with the slipper clutch and the air shifted 5-speed Liberty is that there is no torque converter in there, and that means that there is no converter slip, which is another common problem with automatic transmission. So anyway, probably more than enough enough information already. If you want to find out more, head across to our YouTube channel and make sure you subscribe to our channel while you're over there. You can check that out along with heaps of other amazing videos. Lastly for today, we are still running another giveaway. This is in conjunction with K1 Technology for a set of their shelf stock rods. So if you are at a position where you're considering an engine building project, this is the perfect opportunity to get your name into the draw. They will be giving away any of their shelf stock rods. So these suit most of the popular brands of engine out there. So if you're dealing with something that's relatively mainstream, there's a pretty good chance that they've got you covered there. And this will also go along with our full suite of engine building courses. So you actually learn how to build your own engines with our engine building fundamentals course, our practical engine building course. You'll also get our CAM degree course and access to our private members only online community with our gold membership. So I'll get Jono to chuck a link in the comments there that you can follow if you want to get your name into the draw. I'm not actually too sure exactly how long that's got left to go, but I'd probably hurry up because I don't think it's running for too much longer. All right, give us a second here, guys, and we'll get started with today's webinar.